Hi guys, and welcome back to PGL Tavern Tales Spring Edition. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Raven and Thijs joining us on the couch. Thijs, we just won your match. How are you feeling today?
Pretty good. I mean, you can't have a better start of the day. So yeah, really happy about my series. I also happy about the performance overall here. And now I'm happy to also cast the match.
Perfect. We are happy to have you. And Raven, we are going to cast the next match, Powder versus Game King. Are you excited for that specifically?
Yeah, I am actually. This is a match I wanted to cast when we saw the first version of the bracket come out. Powder versus Game King was definitely probably my favorite game that I had across the whole first top 16. So looking forward to this one.
All right. And Thijs, what do you know about Powder? He's been around. He's our friend, and we did hang out with him a lot. I'm not sure if he ever won a tournament, but he's been in a lot of finals. Like, he's the ultimate second place, the final boss.
Yeah, I have been in that spot for a long time too, and it's a hard spot to be in, that you are like always at these tournaments, always qualifying, always performing, but never really taking the tournament. And yeah, maybe this is the chance for him. Last time at DreamHack Bucharest, he actually beat me too, and I think he went top four there. So yeah, and he's also able to really switch things around. I remember last time when you called Switch Decks, he just totally changed his lineup, like not even one particular similar deck, so maybe he just totally did the same again here.
All right, and Game King, a player that most of the pros know because he's been around playing for F2K, but maybe a lot of viewers are not familiar with him. Raven, what do we know about him?
Yeah, so he's a really good player. I know a few of the guys on Fate to Karma that he's a member of, and everyone just rates him really highly. He made the Aggro Paladin deck, or the most recent version of it, that performed really well for him and a few others that used it overall as well. So he definitely likes to build his decks himself, or at least alter some. And yeah, just a strong player overall. I'm not surprised at all to see him in top 16.
All right. And guys, we actually sat down with those players and asked them some questions. So let's see what they have to say themselves.
Hello, I am Harold Powder Gimre. I am a Swedish Hearthstone professional. I play for SK Gaming.
My name is Game King. I'm 18 years old. Come from Austria. I'm playing currently 13 Fate to Karma. And yeah, qualified for the tournament. Pretty happy.
The reason everyone is here is because you want to win. That's why we play Hearthstone. That's why we compete. We want to be the best, and we want to show that we have what it takes to be the best. And of course, a little bit of money, that's a little bit of incentive as well. So
only open qualifier, only open spots is like the best that can happen. Like, if you like only invites, it's like pretty hard to get in. Like, and there are also BlizzCon points, which I need. And yeah, just one of the best tournaments of the whole year. 25k, nice prize pool. Yeah, and Swiss, the Swiss format is also good, like, perfect.
My day today started off pretty poorly. I lost two games pretty early, but I mean, I'm here, I'm in the top 16, so I mean, I'm happy, I'm satisfied. So now we have another day tomorrow where you have to start winning now, a single elimination, so can't lose anymore.
Like, as expected, like Secret Paladin, Druid, Patron, and maybe Sue, or Reno. But like, that's what my lineup was built against, and yeah, worked out really well.
I don't think anyone specifically surprised me. I mean, Thijs went 5-0, and that's always surprising. I mean, someone has to do it, and Thijs is one of the best players in the world. It's always surprising to see him do so well so consistently, so probably him. That's the most surprising.
Yeah, I think my decks are not that bad, and like maybe I changed my warrior, but like I keep it now secret because the other players will. I don't know. I don't want them to know that, like, what change I did.
Powder versus Game King. What a great guys overall, right? And such praise for you, Thijs, as well. How did it feel, like, them mentioning you as one of the best players in the world?
Yeah, I really appreciate it. It's always, I try to be consistent, and if it gets appreciated, that's always amazing to hear, especially from other pro players.
Yeah, it's definitely something that's going to come into the sort of how the scene reviews players this year, especially because there's so many more open tournaments. Like, consistency is really going to shine through as like a major point to see how good someone is.
I liked how Game King mentioned the HCT points for the spring prelims. Like right now, every pro player is actually hunting for them, and they do mean a lot. What do they mean for you guys, the points for the prelims?
They are important for me. It's not everything. I also really, because a big part of it is letter, and I really enjoy lettering, but I enjoy it while streaming, and it's all every season it's another grind. So I'm actually also happy that there are tournaments that where you can grab some points, because the issue with lettering, it's not really the same as the tournament scene, and having it's good that the tournaments also have points. So BlizzCon is also a tournament, and I would like to be there again, so I'm for sure motivated to absolutely also gain points.
All right, those guys are motivated as well. Yeah. Powder really wants to win, and he did stress that out, that he is here to win. So the fact that he got second many times, it means that he's an amazing player. He made so many finals. I think he made around 6 finals at least. He wasn't able to win them, but just qualifying for tournaments and just going through them. I remember many tournaments where Powder was not invited. He just invited himself through this qualifying.
Yeah, just do it the hard way. But, you know, we're going to see more of that going forward. But, yeah, I agree. I think Powder's just definitely, I just want to take a first place finish this time.
So who do you guys think is going to take it? The predictions are on screen. The Twitch chat says Powder is going to take it 61%, Game King 39%, and Twitter is in favor of Game King. But your personal preferences, Raven first.
It's really tough. I think Powder might take it if I had to pick one. But both these guys, like, that's why I'm so excited for the match. Mm-hmm. Like, they're both extremely good players. I'm looking forward to see what they've in terms of what decks they've brought as well.
All right, Thijs.
Yeah, I also like the lineup. What I saw, Priest, I saw Rogue, and a lot of different. They have a totally different lineup, so it's we're gonna see some really cool, interesting matches. And I don't know what is my favorite yet. I think Powder has a really good. He's also really able to pick up other classes in tournaments, so that might give an edge.
All right, I will put my heart into Game King. I think this is one of the biggest tournaments for him so far. When he can shine, he can show Fate to Karma as the team as well. And, you know, Fate to Karma overall, they have some really good players like Defalor.
Cypher,
absolutely.
Scott, I just went straight for the UK player there, but...
Sure. I want to mention Vortex as well, but... they do have a nice lineup. So he has a great practice partners, but so does Powder in SK Gaming. All right, the first game is starting right now, so we are going straight into Warlock versus Paladin.
Yep, and it looks like Zoo versus the Secret Paladin. Who do you think is actually favored in this
one? I don't know if it's really a Zoo with Mortal Coil. I know Powder also...
Oh, Mortal Coil, of course. Yeah, I'm being completely blind, just deciding to ignore the card in the middle there, and even though it's gold.
I know yesterday he played, I think it was Reno, so I guess that might be still the case. Can also be an... Dragon Warlock made around Meligos. Also know that he plays it from time to time.
Yeah, actually, Powder, when I think about Powder in decks, he's mostly playing control decks. Like, he was, in the past, he was bringing Freeze Mage, Control Warrior, Control Paladin, and he can play any deck, obviously, as a great tournament player, but he does favor the control mostly.
Oh man, that pickup there is pretty amazing. If you look at the curve that he has here, like this coin, especially in control matchups, like, you don't really want a coin early. You want to have that coin challenger, having that big threat on the board, getting your secrets out so you don't draw them anymore.
Yeah, and I really like, Secret Keeper as a card in itself is actually really amazing in Secret Paladin, because not only do you have the potential to buff it with any secrets you do draw, so it makes like that draw, you know, a little bit better and not as bad, but also it needs to be answered, because the times when you don't answer this card early on, it can run away with the game, like, completely. We've seen in some previous matches where Secret Keepers go up to like 4/5s in a couple of turns, like with like an Avenge and stuff, so definitely rough. And Powder's going to choose to just Life Tap here and just ignore it for this turn, which is fair, because he doesn't really have a good way of dealing with it, except for the Owl, but that's probably got more use later on.
Yeah, let's talk more about Powder's hand, because we know that for Game King, this hand is really good, especially with now the second Secret Keep, Mr. Challenger in his hand as well. But for Powder, this matchup is a bit tricky for Reno Lock, and I believe this is the Reno Lock.
Yeah, it's definitely a tough one. I think that for Powder, he needs to be able to clear the board quite efficiently early on. And already he's struggling with that because he's not drawn any Borg players until I've said that typically, and then he draws Demon Wrath. That's always the way. So he definitely has a good option here. He could settle a better Demon Wrath going forward. But getting those Borg players early on are pretty key because you don't want to slam Reno on six on a board full of, a Paladin's full board because they're just going to hit you back down again.
Yeah, but you do want to have Reno in your hand. And I think Reno is really important in this matchup as well because you will clear Paladin. If you get something like Demon Wrath, Hellfire, Paladin will try to deal that damage to you. And then at some point you will get board control, but if you don't have Reno in your hand or just a possibility to heal yourself, you're just going to die to whatever's left.
Yeah, and at some point when you're going to the later stage of the game, it's pretty likely that the Paladin will have a board where they can deal with your life total if you are at half of the lives. If at 15 or something, there just has to be one boom and you're already scared of dying, so really important.
Yeah, it's going to be nice. He's going to use that to clear up the Brand, which is really good because Brand didn't really get any value except for, forcing a trade. This is opening up to a huge Demon Wrath, though.
Oh, man.
So
also to Hellfire, to kind of everything.
Do you think that was worth the trade into Brand, like the threat Brand presents overall as a card? Or do you think that was a bit too plain into AoE too much?
I think in that point, Brand is really overestimated. Like, I had a lot of thoughts also about it, and I was like, yeah, what can people do at turn 4 or turn 5 when there is, like, a Twilight Drake is a really scary card, but... Mm. And as a Drake, like the dragons are really scary somehow, but for the rest, it's really sometimes
it's not like
that much.
Well, if Defender of Argus comes down, then it's double buffing, but only double buffing Brand.
Yeah.
So there's nothing too heavy, but he does recover with the mini bot hero power, and then he's got the potential Bless of Kings onto one of these creatures next turn. So we'll see how Powder chooses to deal with this.
Yeah, for now it doesn't look bad for Game King still. Those Mr. Changers. There is no big game hunter for Powder
as
yet.
Long as he doesn't implosion the mini bot.
implosion mini bots. Don't implosion divine shields.
We've all learned that the hard way.
Yeah, I have to admit, I had it once too, that I really implosioned the divine shield.
And I bet you've never done it again. Like,
no.
The second you do it once, it's no, I'm done, okay.
So just for the viewers, it basically doesn't work. Well, it does.
It works. It pops the divine shield.
It pops the divine shield, yeah.
But that's it.
No imps are getting spawned.
Yeah, so Powder's actually playing the 2/3 on the board there, just to put something there, and start to challenge these minions, because you can't just let the Paladin build things up. This is interesting, the mini bot hero power, because you definitely want to set up as big a board as possible the turn before you're going to play Challenger, because you want that power from Venge spread across the board and not all just on one minion, where we know Reno Lock runs things like the Game Hunter, Siphon Soul, that can just instantly deal with that one big creature.
Yeah, specifically because you don't want to have Avenged Land, as you mentioned, the Big Game Hunter, possibly, or even Competitive Spirit that you're getting from Mystery Challenger to get some value, at least, even if Mystery Challenger is dealt with.
Now, this is an interesting turn. You could go with Emperor this turn just because you have so many high-value cards, then you just reduce it all down. He could have played, like, Zombie Chow and, Argus, for example, just to, build the board and try and slow this down, but it definitely wouldn't be enough when you're expecting Challenger.
By the way, Mal'Ganis, let's talk about it. It is not a common card in Reno Lock.
I think it's an Reno Demon Lock version, because we also see Jirexis. It's pretty likely that there is some Void Caller also in. You can really tech your Reno. Like, it's a really open deck. It just has Reno, and you just put 29 really good cards together with them. And you can really... I tried this Demon version too, and it's really okay. Sometimes it's amazing. So, and it's...
I think that's the payoff, isn't it?
It really makes the matchup against Root so much better. Like, Reno is really not that strong against Root, but with the... early Jirexis just on board, or even a Void Caller, is really tricky.
Yeah, and there are some times where, like, Mal'Ganis would just win you the game. Like, when the second your opponent can't deal with it, like, the game's just over there. So it's interesting, like, he's probably not then running some burst, right? Not running the burst combo if he's running all the demons.
Yeah, I think it's no combo. No Gracie Arcane Golem PO combos, probably.
So more stable with a bit more punch.
Ooh.
Mind control tech, wow.
Everyone takes a gasp as this could go really well or really bad.
Are there two good ones to steal, right? I mean, I would also be happy if you can steal the 2/2 Divine Shield.
Yeah, true. Because you can even play the mind control tech and Argus as well, and Dart Bomb as well if you really want. So it definitely has a lot of options. Here we go, though.
Is it a 6/6?
Oh, okay.
That's fine.
It's
fine.
Fair, right? It's fair. It feels like fair.
Tice agrees that
like
that was a fair outcome.
I like these outcomes the most.
Well, would you now for a 6/6 anyway, right?
Would you prefer if Mind Control Tech said, take the fairest minion off the board, like, you know, switch that one.
Target minion?
Yeah.
It's just so rough sometimes, like if you win or lose to...
It's very swingy.
Yeah, it's really swingy.
But then Mind Control Tech is funny. It's coming back again because people play it in Reno Lock, and some people even play it in Druid.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's like a direct counter to the Paladin sometimes. When with the Muster, they already create three minions. Yeah.
Or even with like a Mysterious Challenger, because like the interaction creates the Noble Sacrifice as well. Then you only need two more minions to potentially steal the 6/6.
And Zoo is popular, so Zoo mostly has.
Yeah, it's really good against Zoo. Really good. Wow, the full tree looks beautiful. I hate it when there are four. Like that, you're like having the one missing. Yeah.
It's got to be even, right?
It feels incomplete.
But do you, which version do you prefer, you personally? Do you prefer the Repentance Competitive Spirit, or do you prefer just having free secrets?
I think it's just also a bit important to mix it up so your opponent just doesn't know. The secret it's all about, it is a secret, and it has to stay a secret. That is, they are only costing one mana. You don't want to play them, actually, but because you have the Challenger, you can get them out of the deck, because in general, the cards are not amazing.
And the thing is, as well, against certain decks, like a card like Repentance is so powerful.
Yeah.
It was in Druid. Like, what do they play? Unless they have Keeper of the Grove or an Aspirant, anything else in that whole deck getting Repentance.
Even
is
that,
huge.
Like one mana, deal two damage or deal three damage is already pretty decent.
Well, you know you can almost certainly kill something next turn, whatever's played. So yeah. It's really good. It frees Mage with Doomsayers, things like that. Like, it's huge.
Yeah, it can certainly find its spots. With Repentance.
But yeah, it's also pretty bad. Like, I had it yesterday, and I just play in a Ruby and Egg, or you play the Paladin Mirror. It's not really a good card. Sometimes if you go first, and you play a Challenger, and he tries to counter it, but his one gets weaker.
But here, Powder is in a good shape. He is blocking that board overall. He's still at 16. He has Draxus and Mal'Ganis. So already having great demons in hand.
And that's a really good Repentance target as well. You don't really care too much about the Argus. It's still going to do some work, but you know, it's not really too much of a big deal. And I think the second Powder draws into, say, Reno. Maybe not even Axe, he has Draxus.
He has everything almost.
Yeah, like if he draws into Reno, though, he's feeling like really safe because, you know, leaving only one minion on the board, or on the other side of the board there, when there's three taunts down and two more minions to deal with this 7/7 is pretty huge. Even has the Implosion.
I think mostly he is in a comfy spot because you do not expect Consecration that much from Secret Paladin. A lot of Secret Paladins are carrying Consecration totally out of the deck or playing a one-off, and you definitely do not expect Equality Consecration from Secret Paladin. Mm. So you're in a comfort zone. Like, the more minions you have with taunts, the better you feel. Especially if you have a great endgame like Mal'Ganis and Draxus.
Yep, so this is looking pretty rough, to be honest, for Game King, especially because he would have to play the Avenge out of his hand, because we've already seen one pulled from the Challenger, and then he has the second one there. So if he played the Mysterious Challenger now, he'd still have to play the Avenge, which means he couldn't Hero Power, so it just makes his turn a little bit weaker. Much preferred to get the additional minion on the board with the Shredder and still play the Avenge.
And he also had already double Noble Sacrifice out because he played one early, so I think this Challenger will be pretty
empty. Six, six.
Yeah.
Done.
Will it be one secret? Like one redemption? Probably?
There will be a lot of secrets if you also play in Repentance and double redemption. Like, then your deck is 9 or 8 secrets.
Yeah. You mostly play one Repentance, one Competitive. Maybe double Redemption, double Sacrifice, double Avenge.
So the Avenge goes on probably the best target for Game King overall. But the issue here is, like, this is really interesting because I was weighing up, do you just kill off that 4-1 with the Chow and the 2-1, leave the taunts and go face and just slam your Draxus and just get it down? Although you can't Hero Power as well because the Draxus is reduced, but you're on 9 mana. I'm a bit of a fan of just getting Draxus down while you're as safe as possible.
I think Powder really wants to get in super good Mal'Ganis here. Like, getting the Implosion sound, getting the Imgang Boss out this turn, it makes the Mal'Ganis like buffing the whole board. And if you play Draxus right after, then you can just attack whatever you want without taking damage.
Yeah, that's really good. So what's the worst card that can happen? Tyrion?
Probably, but even Tyrion probably isn't that scary with the Mal'Ganis follow-up. Because it means that Tyrion, he could kill Tyrion with those three minions already. He can still life tap, and then it means that you presume that the Ashbringer has to go into the Mal'Ganis, which then, you know, is 9 damage, and it still requires more. So yeah, 6/6 for 6. Not horrendous, but not great either.
Good stats, come on.
It's okay. And the Muster's going to be just fill out the curve quite nicely there. Equip the weapon to what he thinks can deal with these imps until the Mal'Ganis comes down. Do you think you just drop Mal'Ganis here?
Yeah.
There we go.
It's pretty insane here.
Yeah, you can easily trade with the Mistress Challenger.
Yeah, and even a Shadow Flame for you know, maybe next turn.
Also, the Imp Gang boss, is instead of getting a 1-1, you get a 3-3 for, you know, like it's infinite value almost.
That's quite good.
Game King does have an answer to this, though, because he does have Keeper of Alderman and 3 damage on the board to be able to just directly kill Mal'Ganis.
But he can get more Imps, actually, on the board as well. Whoops. That was a knife that didn't do much.
The knife jiggler tried.
Yeah, he did his best. No, Mal'Ganis was supposed to be eternal.
Even now, though, with this board, like, Drax is still good.
Oh, that looks good. That doesn't work, actually, when you, like, hover over a card, you click on it, and then the knife goes there.
If it works, you say that it's because of that. If it doesn't work, yeah, then it's you find another solution.
But still, Powder is in a great spot. He can clear it, but there's no need to.
No, I don't think he really feels pressure with making this clear. 5 on board. The only, like, with no cards, if there's at least no Divine Favor, it can only be 4 damage more normal.
Yeah.
Secret Keeper, not the best. Is really good card, but not the best draw when you are having no cards.
This is, you know, believe it or not, you know, to everyone watching, this is actually a downside. You know, secret patterns does have a downside, and it's late game top decks are actually normally quite bad because you're top decking cards like Secret Keeper, Haunted Creeper, things like that, where they're just like low impact on the board. Whereas obviously the Reno locks top decks or card draw in overall is normally singularly like very powerful.
Yeah, absolutely. It's funny how he will not top deck any secrets anymore because he pulled all of them out of his deck. But he still has Dr. Boom, Tyrion, what else? Maybe another Keeper of Ulduman.
Yeah, I think he's just really needing Tyrion or Boom here because, you know, as these turns go on, like, Powder's only going to get, you know, build a more and more powerful board. And as you were saying earlier, Tyce, the top deck damage potential from Paladin pretty much stops at 4.
Jarax's turn? Not yet.
Still no Reno, but I'm pretty sure it will be in there.
Oh, so we need that young Dragonhawk.
So what do you think about Jarax overall in this situation? Do you wait for Reno and try to heal yourself up and just keep Jarax as a final safeguard?
I think Powder just knows that if you are having the board, you can't lose anymore. Yeah. So the only thing he's doing, making the best board he can and making so sure that he cannot that Game King cannot get away out of this game.
Oh.
Yeah, he's not doing anything too crazy at all. He's just like, Draxus doesn't need to come down, does it? He has so many options and continues to have so many options. He has a Shadow Flame if things get dicey. He has Siphon Soul for the potential of Tyrion, just removing it straight off the board. Yeah, he doesn't need to do anything fancier at all.
Yeah, Draxus can be used maybe as a card
Reno
that deals damage, basically as the last 3 damage.
Yeah, you can just use it if something crazy really happens. And the Reno follow-up now is pretty nice. Just putting back onto full health. Ignores the 2-1-1s and says, I'm going to finish this game next turn.
We're going to be rich. Well, Game King, now the game is reset more or less, but this is a much worse situation when there was turn 1.
A little bit. Just a little bit.
Actually, really smart from Game King to still do this move, to maybe get some information if there is a surprising demon in the deck. Because he knows that this game is quite over, but there is... He's going to face the deck again. And getting a bit more information, I had it yesterday too, like getting some really information about the secrets that were out that were surprising for me. So it can be really important.
Especially versus Reno Log, as you mentioned, Reno Log is mostly Reno plus cards. Mm-hmm. So if you know, like, hey, there was Mal'Ganis, but was there Jaraxxus? Was there a Doomguard maybe? Like, you want to know those things, right? And now he knows that the demons are there, so he might assume, I haven't seen Power of Overwhelming, I haven't seen Arcane Golem, I haven't seen Leroy, I haven't seen Stalag and Fugain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the thing is, there's no reason not to, right? You're not actually losing anything by just quickly making that trade for 10 seconds and then ending the game. So, yeah, I agree. I think it's really good play.
Yeah, he got a lot of information. He knows Mind Control Tech is there, so he's seen a lot of the deck. And especially in the last hero standing, because Powder will have to stay with his Reno lock, and now Game King has to pick another deck to face it.
It's really funny because in Conquest it really doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You just don't want to do it because then you you just give away more from your own deck.
Yeah, yeah. It just works on like a flipped way, doesn't it? There was the steal there of the 2-2, the fair steal.
I really like the highlights. They show up so fast, and we can see the best moments out of the games.
But in general, this is a really interesting matchup because I feel like it's so close all the time, like Reno against Paladin. I have to say, this one really went away, but it was really early where Powder had just an insane clear. I'm not sure if there were like any options to play a bit better around that, because with the double Challenger and Blessing, you were really stuck with an empty hand.
Yeah. It was a tough one because he built up the board. What did he kill?
The Bran, but yeah, it was everything died from
everything
that
was on
point.
One health, right? So like,
maybe you just ignore it for the turn and deal with it next turn.
Especially
and
if you have that
coin
many minions.
Challenger afterwards will be really amazing.
Especially if you have that many minions, then there was a potential that Blessed of Kings comes down next turn on one of your minions and then just kills Bran. And then you just move forward from that with that challenger or whatever, like you said. So yeah, definitely interesting. I think that was one of the more swingy turns of that match. Mainly because like the Demon Wrath came straight off the top for Powder, which was pretty sick. If you didn't have that,
but it's hard to say that was really a misplay, right? That was just a different line, hoping that there will not be the Demon Wrath just coming to the board or Hellfire. Okay, so another game is ready. This time, Game King is queuing up his Warlock. I just wanted to say what kind of deck this is, but it doesn't tell me.
Don't
much
make
yet.
My mistake, Nim.
Yeah, it can be it can be anything at this point, right?
Yeah, this can be. These are cards you can see in Zoo and that people play in Reno. If you pick the Warlock into Warlock, well, you don't want to pick Priest, so it can still, yeah.
And one of the interesting points as well is if this is Reno Lock, then if it has if it's the Burst variant, I think it's favored versus the Demon variant, just because you can just kill them.
Like, I agree.
You know, there's no like. It's the same with the older variants of Reno Lock, where like the Stalagm Fugan style, where it's just very slow and board control. You know, if you can just burst someone down, it just doesn't matter because Reno has a much lower impact. But now we can see after the Mulligan.
This is actually the
Zoo deck.
But this is a problem for Game King because I think personally Zoo is not that good versus Reno Lock, and I haven't seen many games where Zoo was able to overpower Reno. Obviously. It's kind of like the old Handlock matchup where Zoo just has to close their eyes and move forward and try to kill Reno Lock before Reno Lock is able to stabilize. But there's a lot of tools to deal with the early game.
It's a bit better, in my opinion, than the Zoo against Handlock. Like, that was really a problem because the minions were so valuable, the Moltons were so swingy. At least this Reno deck plays only one of these cards.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, it's probably not that good. But the value, like Zoo, is really a deck that runs quite a lot of value. And sometimes you just go quite all in and you just hope there is no Reno. And sometimes you can even survive the Reno.
Yeah, because the thing is, like, it's again similar to Secret Paladin. If you build up the board, pressure them hard, then all they can do is Reno on 6. That's it. And then you pressure them again, then they need a good board clear. And board clear versus Zoo is generally quite difficult because of the sticky minions. And
demons. Like, Demon Wrath doesn't always work as well.
Yeah. And kind of cool what you were saying before, Tice, about sort of fishing if there's any interesting demons in the deck. Because we do see there is. Like, a Dread Infernal isn't the most common card we ever see in Hearthstone. And kind of cool that it might actually be played on 6 and get some really good use out of that one AoE damage versus Zoo.
And Tice, what do you think about this new version with Sea Giants? How does it change this matchup? Are Sea Giants really good versus Reno?
No, this matchup it will be one of the weaker. And you don't really want it in this matchup. You don't want it against Druid. It's just so good in Mirrors against Paladin against. Just for these matchup, it's an insane tech because it's not because you play a lot of minions. They also play a lot of minions.
Yeah.
So, When you can play Sea Giants for less than 4 mana, I find them really, really strong. At 4 mana, they are okay.
Yeah, because the thing is, especially, like, Paladin only really has the Keeper of Alderman to deal with it, and then Zoo doesn't really have anything to deal with an 8-8. They have to just either power through, and if you get, like, a taunt on it as well, it really does just decide the game. But
or Wind Fury.
Yeah, or Wind Fury is pretty decent as well.
Yeah, I really liked the play Powder to Gloucester. Like, he had the MC tech, but didn't go super greedy by not tapping. He knew there was, like, if he would silence, Game King will still play his minions. You're not going to trade your 3-2 in the 2-1.
Yeah.
So, good call. Ooh, wow, is that a BGH in Zoo?
So there is something to counter.
Yeah, he's not only, like, playing the Sea Giants, he's also countering the opponent's Sea Giants.
But honestly, we've seen a lot of Sea Giants yesterday, and we've seen Gaara running the Big Game Hunter in the Zoo deck as well. So
that's so funny, though, because like the tech in the Zoo mirror is to put Sea Giants in, and then the tech against the tech is to put BGHs in. It's like...
So which tech can we put in for the BGH now? That's like the real question,
right? The tech against that is to just play the original list that stops at 5.
Okay.
Play the Doom Guards.
Yeah, that can work, actually.
Just go full circle again.
And then you're just sitting on your BGH and you're like, do I play this tempo card or do I expect this?
Always tempo BGH. This is kind of an interesting turn, though. The egg was like a weird steal for the MCT. Because you don't normally have a good way to proc it other than like Hellfire or Demon Wrath as the Zoo lock, the Reno lock. So it's good that it's there because it makes his AoEs a lot better.
PO, Shadow Flame.
Yeah, that's true.
Or Abusive, possibly.
It's a second deck though.
Opposing Juggler can be fun. Just soak some damage.
Are you just listing every potential outcome of popping that egg?
Well, I did see some of them actually popping. Like, even when Tice actually played his egg into the Repentance yesterday, we seen a Knife Juggle just popping the egg.
It's also, like, with Demon Wrath and Hellfire, all these AoEs are not only good now against your opponent, they're also good for you on for your board. So,
yeah, I think egg was all right, but it's absolutely an awkward steal, for sure.
Really slow turn there for Game King by only playing an egg there, so not really developing the board, and now... Powder just has the opportunity to totally take the control over. He can give him even double X now by PLing the Squire. You cannot do anything with the X. Here's another one.
Hmm. Raven doesn't mean like he's putting all the eggs in one basket.
Very good, Nims. The first one of the day, I like it. first one of the day from game two, though. I expected more from game one. But yes, he definitely is. This is a rough one. I think. Do you want to give him the egg, or do you want to give him the chance at 2-2, I guess?
Ooh, Corruption.
Your favorite card, Tyus.
I like it.
Especially when you face Mal'Ganis, right?
It's such an interesting card, because it pops at the start of your turn, so you can also interact really well with it. That's
It forces your opponent to play a weirder turn, because then they have to be like probably more aggressive with the card that's Corruption.
I think after I played Corruption against Game King yesterday, he doesn't see another option and picking it himself now.
Tice showed me this card was good, right?
Yeah, so Corruption is definitely a good card.
It's also, what can you even, like, yeah, he will still steal something, but there is not that much on the board.
Yeah, well, attack Shadow Flame could be good.
What about
this? Because you steal the 4-4, right?
Yeah, exactly. What about stealing the 4-4?
And you can still play the Peddler, so... I mean, there's a lot of options here, and this is sort of like the fun, of Arena.
Do you want to spend your your strongest AoE card by making sure you steal the best one? I mean, if you don't do much or you trade, you still steal something, and the board is almost empty.
What about stealing just an egg? Dark Peddler into Mortal Coil or Elven Archer or Stormtusk Borkil, the 1-1, attack with Sylvanas in the 2-2, and you just steal that egg.
I don't mind even...
You can use Dread Infernal.
Yeah,
challenge.
I don't like this.
I think this is okay.
Even better.
Because then you guarantee the egg, and the Sylvanas... The damage on the Sylvanas doesn't matter because it's going to die anyway. And this actually pushes you slightly closer to Molten Giant.
Where's the Zoo now? That's the question.
Yeah. I would just borrow those eggs.
Yeah, this is kind of rough because... Sea Giant looks like the card you kind of need to sort of come back here, but you know that Reno Lock runs so many like just direct answers, whether it's a BGH or a Siphon Soul, to just instantly deal with the Sea Giant.
That's why I think I like Leer in the Zoo lists, because with Leer you at least have a bit more burst, and Reno Lock, like, you have to kill this Reno Lock as soon as possible. When Reno comes down, you cannot do much, and there is the Molten Giant as well.
So actually, a bit tricky turn here for Powder, with not having the direct answer for Sea Giant. You are a bit low on life, so you don't have Taunt. So yeah, I actually like to just see. Maybe you can like pick up
PO
something good. Yeah.
Or even Abusive is fine. Yeah.
PO is good as well.
Yeah. Taunt is already decent. So
with PO, you can attack others.
Abusive, that'll do. Corruption.
I saw the Corruption, but then I saw Abusive is a good ear, sadly.
Just conditioned himself to play Corruption, no matter what. So, do you Abusive face and then Shadow Flame, or do you want to do you want to just like abusive trade the 8-8 and leave 3-2 up and save Shadow Flame? Because I'm just feeling like, you know, the zoo isn't building up much of a board, and if you Shadow Flame now, then he's not going to build up much of a board.
You can also Shadow Flame the egg, yeah. And then just cool. Still make the trade.
Alright, that's cool. Not only he clears, he also gets more power on board, and Zoo is already at 11.
Yeah, it's really interesting that Reno Lux wins two games without... Well, he had Reno last turn, but he really didn't need it. And
yeah.
He just
yeah.
has the board control. And that shows the power of Reno Lux. Yes, you play 30 different cards, but if you can just put all the powerful cards together and have some good removal, it can just also just really win on board.
I think that's why a lot of players really like Reno Lux, because it really does, like, put in your hands. You make the most out of each card you draw, and it's very decision-heavy.
That's
deck,
it, by the way,
so.
With Jaraxxus. Or well, no, there's not enough mana. Okay.
6, 8. Well this help. Oh, no.
No.
Also that.
So close, right?
Come on, guys. Maths. Not that I can talk.
Okay. Well, so he can clear and play something big on his side. So
yeah. The only thing you just want to do now every turn is clearing the board from the zoo. You don't want to get, like... lose this game by getting double PO'd with a Doomguard. Like, it's pretty... It can happen, and you just want to clear everything they have now. This is actually going to be quite funny, because you play the Molten Giant against the Zoo, and you're like, oh, now the game is locked, and there isn't BGH.
Yeah, it's
like, going to be pretty funny.
It's like, normally it goes to different, yeah.
And there is the Zombie Chow as well.
So actually, this is not a. It's actually a strong turn.
Yeah, he can actually play both the minions and the Argus as well. So seems pretty reasonable. And the only problem is it going to be good enough to deal with Drax this next turn?
I don't even think you.
Oh yeah, you might not actually play it.
I don't think Powder really considers Draxus at all, because there is 9 damage on board and you can die pretty easily.
Yeah, and Hellfire kind of lines up pretty okay as well. It's going to clear the board minus the 2/1s. It's whether he's confident enough, but like, I think Hellfire low Theb, like,
yeah,
you're not too afraid of anything like 10 damage from hand from Zoo with no spells or very little spells.
Well, there's 2 minions on board, so it's 2 already, right?
And you get a 4/4 yourself with this egg
yeah,
still
exactly,
on board.
Yeah.
But low Theb just makes it sure you're always scared of like the PO Doomguard.
Exactly,
but
yeah.
With making sure that cannot happen now.
Yeah, this is nice.
There are maybe ways that you can die now with Doomguard and Direwolf and Abusive, like these 3 cards together.
That's an abusive.
Ooh. Abusive into...
That's 2 damage off.
A minion and Gormok.
Yeah.
So, just getting your second abusive and you got it, right? Oh, almost.
Not really.
If that wasn't abusive, that's...
Well, the thing is here, you can still go face and be pretty confident about not dying, right?
Clearing Glowfab is probably good, though.
Yeah, because even if the Voidwalker dies, there is still no... it's not lethal on board.
Yeah.
You saw a Hellfire gone. You saw Dark Bomb being gone. So I would really take the odds here and just hope there is no other...
So would you just go for face with all this?
I think you have no other option. You cannot play around Reno anymore.
The thing is as well, if you use the PO, it actually makes him... You can't tap. He either has Reno, because he puts him to 2, right?
Yeah,
so
that's true.
So, and the thing that's is, true. You might, you know, like, you might not have a minion on board, and then what if you draw Doomguard or something, even though I don't think it's in this deck. But, you know, like, I think you put him to 2, stop the tap, and he needs Reno or Healbot now.
Yeah, but you know, there's, like, you saw Jiraxxus in the deck, you know it's a demon version, and if there are cards that are not being played yet, it can be Mal'Ganis, Jiraxxus, that are cards that are really long in the hand.
I think it's really difficult, though, because I think you had to go for it at that point, because if you
so
didn't,
too.
Then the game's just going on and on, and you're getting in a worse and worse position, so...
Even with the PO in hand, I think, like, you cannot tap anymore. He's going to put you at 2 lives, or not.
Yeah. I think you just have to take that risk. And now Powder's just choosing whether he wants to leave the 1-1 up. He does clear it off the board again. Just, we saw this play last game, right, where it's just like... I'm just going to remove all your potential outs from the game and win.
If things go wrong, they always go horribly wrong.
But I like the approach from Game King. Like, he was basically laughing it off. He was like, oh yeah, he has Jax. Oh, I hit for 2.
Yeah, but even with the PO still in hand, then at that moment, he couldn't play around Reno anymore. He couldn't play around Jiraxxus. His options were really limited, and he took his outs. And there was...
It's completely the right play to go for it, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was, and that was, again, just another rough matchup, I'd say. Like,
absolutely.
Powder really navigated that well again, and showing that, you know, he seems to like his Reno. Like,
even though there was this Big Game Hunter to counter a possible Molten Giant, he wasn't able to come back from there. And now he's left with his Priest. And Thijs, what is the matchup Priest versus Reno?
It's I mean, everybody or people, the handlock was always like, it was unwinnable for Priest. Reno lock, it's not unwinnable, it's better, but it's still pretty bad. So
what kind of Priest are you expecting? Like, are you expecting like the you know, the typical Alcanai Soul Priest, Blade Master Circles, or something more lean towards the
Dragon Priest?
Yeah, the Dragon Priest.
No, I think really in control. If you in tournaments like Control Priest, it's pretty good against aggro. It has that burst potential too with if you have just a Car Hero Power with an Arcanine, with Zombie Chaos, even the Flash Heals are really aggressive. And yeah, I remember that also Zetalot played it in a tournament and he just really won games against Handlocks. And yeah, I think it's still not a good matchup because the value of the minions from Reno and the Handlocks are really powerful. Yeah, it's gonna be difficult for Game King to get back here.
Do you think the matchup is really difficult, or it's just like a lot of people cannot play this matchup correctly because the Priest versus some matchups is super difficult to play, or like different and counterintuitive?
The cool thing about Priest is like the players that play Priest know really well how to play every matchup. And if you play against Priest, I even have sometimes the issue. It's really you don't face that matchup too often, and so it's you always have an advantage by playing playing decks that are not that popular, or at least not on ladder.
Yeah. And Priest does have the ability to snowball as well. Like the second like Valen's Chosen comes down and your opponent can't deal with it, already that minion's very scary.
So what are you looking for as the Reno lock versus Priest?
I like to look for 4 drops. The early drops feel really bad because you're always scared of the Cleric or getting... the Priest can trade into them. I'm always happy with Twilight Drakes, with Shredders. These 4 attack minions where you know that Priest can just not have an answer.
All right. And as a Priest, I believe you just want to have an early game. That's why Mulliganing Circle, Curator, possibly, and... Northshire Cleric to draw more cards for a beginning.
I think Cleric is always good to start with.
So what would be the way for the Priest to win? You know you're facing a deck heal a lot, so you need to either go to Fatigue or burst it down somehow.
Yeah, but if you know there is Mal'Ganis, if you know there is Jirexis, Fatigue is, I don't really think, an option. Maybe if you play in Deathlord, then it can bring you something. Otherwise, I would say you have to put some pressure on the Reno, put him at a life total where you know that if you get the right hand, you can combo him down. Or you just can burst him down from 10, 15 lives.
It's definitely a tough matchup as well. Like looking at this light bomb in hand, I think that is going to have a really heavy impact on the game as to whether Powder plays around it heavily or not. Because if he overcommits to the board, then the light bomb sort of resets the game a little bit. Then that could be really swinging. And Corruption
again. Are we going to only see Corruptions from these Fettlers today?
It's really popular.
Yeah.
What do you actually think about this play of going Voidwalker?
I will always pick Corruption against Priest because you know that once they play...
I think like overall Cleric will be important because as a Priest this matchup is so bad, you need many, many cards to be able to make the best plays every turn, more or less, to win this.
That's, you can see it was super good he didn't play the Cleric because Powder just tapped straight into Mortal Coil, so that would have been insane.
Now turn 5, Vol'jin doesn't look that good.
Vol'jin, go!
Yeah.
Heal pass.
Paying 5 mana for a 5-2. Well, that's just a general Priest issue, right? Pass.
Priest life. Heal pass.
You just have to be really patient. Just heal pass many turns and then hope you can actually win.
Yeah, but the start really doesn't... this is not what you really want in this matchup, at least. Sometimes it's maybe fine, but if you face an Reno lock and at least it's not going to insanely overextend into the big AoEs, it's going to be super rough.
Yeah, because that's the thing. For the Reno lock now, Powder could sit on these two minions for quite a long time because he's putting enough pressure on to out damage the heal from the Priest. but he's not overcommitting to the board at all. Like, do you think that?
Yeah, I think Sylvanas is super good here.
Okay.
I will drop it.
I wonder whether you just Cabal just to steal the 2-2 and then leave just the Belcher on the board. It's a tough one.
Like, Sylvanas can be useful later as well when the big demons come down.
I look really at that Shrinkmaster Cabal from, like, when you get a Death Lord, he gets Jirexus and you steal Jirexus. Like, the dream.
That's not bad, actually.
That's the dream.
Tice always thinking about the big plays.
Yeah. But how do you otherwise deal with the Jirexus?
Yeah, you're right.
Hey, Shadow Word Pain, maybe, man.
Like, the way Priest wins this matchup is by getting Deathlord and them not having Jirexus then in the hand and getting the Jirexus on board. Implosion is not really doing work for both players, but...
Yeah.
I'll say, so now do you play a Cabal because you have two?
Yeah, okay, I agree with you guys.
Or do you maybe Light Bomb because you have two as well?
Or Vol'jin. Oh, wait.
That will not work. All right, so Cabal is building up some pressure, but does Powder feel pressured at all?
Look what I top deck. Play the top deck, Cabal.
Yeah, that was so lucky. I got Cabal.
No, I don't think it's really that impactful here.
That 1-1 could change.
It's a bit,
everything.
So yeah.
I think it's just important for him to get something like a decent body on the board more than anything to just do something with. Because as you said, the more turns you go on just passing, the more cards the Warlock's going to draw and the more things he's going to drop like this.
So from Powder's perspective, he just needs to respond to the board, not allow Priest to do any burst and play his own threats, right? It's from his perspective, it should be a simple game.
Yeah, and for Game King, like you saw, the Sylvanas was a hard one for Powder to deal with. And now, with Vol'jin here in the hand, might be the best answer you have against the Boom.
There's obviously Light Bomb as well, but...
Yeah, but you need to get so much value from Light Bomb in this matchup to make it super impactful.
So how do you think you approach this? Do you think Vol'jin into Deathlord and ignore the 7-2?
No, I will trade the 7-2 away. I will trade the 7-2 for sure away. But I like the play of Vol'jin and Deathlord.
Yeah. Dr. Boom has a lot of health, so Vol'jin would become a really nice minion that's resistant to Big Game Hunter. No. Deathlord's still very good, yeah. Especially because you probably want to play it earlier.
And this is the build-up, guys. This is the build-up for the Draxxus play.
Yeah.
Deathlord is going to summon Draxxus, then he'll steal it.
What else can he steal? That's really nice. Is there anything else that has like 4 attack?
Twilight Drake, Shredders, these
Stealing the Void Caller wouldn't be too terrible. Yeah. Just to negate the value and still put a decent minion on, you know, your side of the board. Even though it's a bit overkill with the attack being only 3. Bomb goes to phase for 2, so not the action Powder was really hoping for there.
Yeah, that doesn't change anything here. Can, of course, consider Scything Soul here. Twisting Nether, not bad either, because you gain a minion. And
how are we going?
I don't think Priest can have a more impactful board, maybe. Oh. Twilight Drake, that is...
You can steal the combo!
Yeah, well...
Oh, wow. The worst thing is there's actually no way for him to deal with this Twilight Drake other than stealing it or playing the Light Bomb. So maybe you do have to steal it because it's still going to be 4 attack, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Anything you play is still going to be a problem.
Yeah, but...
And you put good board on...
I mean, the problem, I think, here is, like, if he plays the Blade Master and heals it, then, like, it's... Yeah, I don't know. It's just open to things like Dark Bomb.
Yeah, but he's
oh, he can heal as well, right? So he does actually just go out of range with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, but the Hellfire clears full board. The Dark Bomb clears the biggest threat. It's still not that good.
What's in the museum?
Oh.
Ooh, that are some really...
Do you ever not go for Shredder?
Yeah, Shredder's the best.
I would, for sure, yeah.
Or would you rely on the second curator getting the Stalag and the Fugue? Push into that.
And I was thinking if you know you're like there are some Reno versions still trying out Fugen and stuff, like then it is reasonable.
This is gonna be such a good player for Powder.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And he can even
getting
go
this value out one of your weaker cards in the matchups just so good. Ooh, and now we get to the interesting part where Game King can consider stealing the Void Caller here. Like he doesn't know if there are any demons in hand then.
And this is the power of a card like this, right? Mm-hmm. Like, even if there aren't, well, your opponent doesn't know that, and if they are in the hand, then this could be a real problem. Like, you know, if you go straight into Mal'Ganis, or even, you know, we saw like the 6/6 the previous game, there's a lot of big minions that can make this Void Caller get a lot of value. I kind of like the steal here, actually.
And you've seen Hellfire, you've seen Twisting Nether, so you know there's Demon Wrath, which doesn't actually affect Void Caller. Shadow Flame, possible. We haven't seen Shadow Flame this game yet, right?
No.
There was no Shadow Flame.
That was last game.
Yeah.
Because I think the issue is, like, if you kind of just want to get Sneeds down as quickly as possible. But leaving the Void Caller just means there can be, like, well, already that's 3 damage, then potentially another demon comes out, and then more that you can do with all the mana. So I like the steal here, just remove it. You've just seen Hellfire use, so you know, you're presuming the board's fairly safe, and you just steal the minion and remove the chance of Powder getting a lot of value from that Void Caller.
The only thing you have to do now is running a Thought Steal, getting these demons, and putting these demons on the board.
Yeah, just to steal everything. Sylvanas! No Shadow Flame, though, for Sylvanas.
Sylvanas is really strong against Priest. You just... Like, there is Entomb, right? So that's a tricky card. But for the rest, no good answers against it.
Actually, we haven't seen any Entombs yet from Game King. But I have to assume he runs at least one.
Yeah, I think it's almost too good not to play, right?
Yeah, you can see that Powder doesn't even want to play Sylvanas here. Just I guess he's just really scared of about it.
Scared of Entomb, right? Because Sylvanas jumps on board, then there is Entomb, you lose Sylvanas, you're open against Sylvanas, and the board is still there, unanswered. And Sylvanas can be really good with Shadow Flame in the future, if by any chance Game King actually builds
out. I
want
to see Powder's reaction to this Sneeds.
Yeah, but this is the power of the Machine Creator, right? Like, you can pick, you can play it early, it's good against aggro, you can pick up anti-aggro cards for Death Rattles, you can pick up these late game cards, so...
Yeah, because if you actually just... show someone the list of death rattles in the game, all those cards, or at least most of them, are pretty damn good, especially when a lot of them are actually legendaries.
Pilot
of
Sky Golem.
So you look at Sylvanas, Ken, you know, like, there are a lot of, like, really impactful cards.
He goes to kill Lothar, but if there would be that Shadow Flame for Sylvanas, that would be so good there.
Just oh, yeah, sweet. Holy. Scything Soul, pretty tricky. Every time I see Sneeds, man, it's an issue for me to
watch. What do I do?
Yeah. I have some pretty big nightmares about this Sneeds.
That's understandable.
What were the worst you got? I think the worst is Kel'Thuzad.
Kel'Thuzad, yeah, for sure.
Oh my god. KT.
Especially when it happens 3 or 4 times in a row. It's really horrible.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Getting something like Deathwing can be annoying because it's like a big creature, but just getting Kel'Thuzad, bringing back Sneeds after that, it's tough.
Oh man,
no
Sylvanas
Entomb.
And no answer.
Do you draw? Try to get that Entomb?
Well, we don't know what is in Game King's deck, but he probably knows if there are Entombs. And if there are Entombs, I think it's for sure worth it. It's...
we go, so it's gonna draw, and this could actually change the game quite a lot. Oh.
Alright, so...
or it couldn't, and it's just a zombie chow. So yeah. It does help with the Sylvanas.
You probably attack... Yeah, you play zombie chow and attack actually into Sylvanas maybe even.
You kind of need to make a trade, otherwise...
Yeah, you have to, because then otherwise the Warlock will do it on the
their
own terms.
Yeah, in how he wants to do it.
And
exactly.
The thing is, he can actually pop the Sneeds if it's stolen anyway with Holy Nova. So,
oh,
wow.
The smile.
Do you Holy Nova here?
I was thinking of Circle.
Oh, Circle. Yeah, Circle's actually pretty good.
Yeah, Circle, and then you can
heal
one.
Heals quite a lot, so...
Heals needs? Yeah, I guess. You still want to keep it as a good minion on board.
Yeah, the longer you keep it alive, the more awkward it stays, doesn't it? Like,
yeah, and also you get it out of range of Line Bomb. Maybe it's gonna matter.
Okay.
So, Powder probably looking for a way to clear with this board. The Demon Wrath does a start of it, and with the Mortal Call Darkbone, like, you have ways, but it's still the problem that it is Sneeds, and...
Do you think you just have to hit the point where you risk it? Because Sneeds can win.
Yeah,
like you know, there are some legendaries that aren't going to do
well
much.
Well, also with having Scything Soul and BGH in hand, like, you should always be fine, right? Or there might still be some outcomes, but...
I like Demon Wrath Infernal, I think. Just you kill everything on board, and Infernal contests needs one.
Oh yeah, that's amazing with the Mortal Call here.
All right, going for Infernal there. It doesn't die to Sneeds, that's great. And Priest will need to find one more damage, which is, we know there is Holy Nova, but normally it's actually hard to get it.
Yeah, so you think we're going to see Holy Nova and the heal onto Sneeds so it trades and stays alive here?
Okay, it's interesting. So you can kill this Dread Infernal if you want. You can just heal your Sneeds first, then Holy Nova, and then make the trade. But yeah, you make it pretty weak. But yeah, otherwise you give him the trade for free. Yeah. So it's a bit...
And plus, you've just seen Coil as well. So even though it'll be on one health, right? If you... okay, he's just going to go for Light Bomb. What's going to come out of Sneeds?
Okay. Oh my god! That's and Powder, look at Powder's face! He's like, are we seriously doing this? That's extra 8 damage!
I mean, that Museum Curator's got a lot to answer for, right? Oh my god.
Oh my
god. That's just a simple. That's 8 damage out of nowhere. He really needs Reno or some kind of a heal next there.
Oh man.
He's just going for it.
And this is just like, with the Nova as well, like this is 4 damage next turn.
There are good plays.
Plus 3 from the.
I mean, there is no Reno, so that's really really horrible. But still, Molten Giant, Siving Soul, and BGH clears the whole board here.
Yeah. Do you guys like this Okanai here? Because with Okanai, you could deal more damage.
It sets up Lethal. That was the good thing. Because you cannot play Okanai, Holy Nova, and Hero Power, yeah. So...
Oh, the top deck Shadow of Death is going to help out. You're just instantly dealing with that giant if he wants, or do you think just a Light Bomb while there's 2 minions on the board?
Yeah, I was also thinking, how is just Holy Nova here past turn and keeping
I suppose
everything.
You can take the damage.
It's just totally past turn, yeah. These are the biggest priest issues, what you do in these situations.
Yeah, because like it's you kind of might want to Shadow Ward Death, but on the other hand, Light Bomb will clear the board eventually. And what can happen? Like you can maybe just even take the damage, just take 12.
That's nearly half your health, though. That's what's a little bit scary. Because the problem is, if he takes the damage, all of it, then you know he can Light Bomb and heal, but then he's on like 14 next turn or something. So it can be a little bit rough.
No way.
Yeah,
to
power
heal.
No heal. You have the Mal'Ganis.
Oh man, it's actually so close, but then on the other hand, how can Priest deal 6 damage?
Yeah.
Or even 4 because he's doing.
But you just like so he's just gonna play super safe, which is fine. I was weighing up something like Bran and Argus. And then
but you're still dying, like there can be one burst card and if you pick up the second one.
Oh man, the problem for Game King is that he will not be able to heal this injured Blade Master, so he'll just die to Light Bomb.
How many cards are there left? I saw 9 for the Priest, but didn't see what Reno had left.
No, I haven't seen it at all.
Oh, that is a really, really big. Yeah, I think you can just...
You don't have to do it this turn.
I kind of...
Nah, you can die to like Alcanai Flesh Heal, so I'm not sure. Mm. Like, the Game King cannot run all of these cards when he runs
like
already Light of the Nerul also.
If you play Draxxus, hit in, then yeah, you're on 11, but what's the Priest going to do from hand for 11? Like, that's actually asking quite a lot with 2 cards. This is kind of awkward.
It's a bit sad. Like, we got so excited by Ragnaros, and he had a chance, but like, even if he would keep the Okanai in hand, that would not be enough damage.
This just stalls the game because it's besides having the Jirexus, you also make the one of the 6/6s already. It's
and the problem is we've seen Light Bomb and Priest just can't deal with
Priest can't deal with this at all.
The problem is like especially from 15 now, Priest normally doesn't have the burst. You know, if they had all those cards available, then we wouldn't be in this position at all anyway.
Oh, and there is
an Entombed Jirexus face.
Entombed so late to the party.
Yeah, that's really yeah, problem is now the value game is not even close anymore.
Yeah,
with Jirexus just making.
Never mind the rest of the cards already in hand.
Yeah.
Like Bran, Argus, you know, things like that. It's just.
You can just. Often you just make the 6/6 and you pass turn, but there is already double Light Bomb gone, so you're not
just
really scared
all in,
anymore. So now Powder can just totally.
And Game King even knows this. He said well played the second the Draxxus was
put
down. So it's worth playing out, of course, so he's not doing anything weird. But yeah, it's definitely an uphill climb here that's probably too steep at this moment in time.
Absolutely, yeah. With the second Okanai, he can't do much as well. So this will be it. Like, there's Lethal on board. He cannot clear those 8/8. So there is a concede from Game King, I believe. And Powder advancing to the top 8. That was really impressive. So Powder will be joining Thais.
We're going to face each other again, me and Powder.
Oh, you're right, because you're in the bracket, right?
Yeah, we are both at the top of the bracket. But no, this was like 3-0-ing with Reno. Really impressive.
Yeah. And I kind of liked how consistent Powder was in terms of his playstyle. It was always just, I'm just not going to die. And because Reno's the type of deck it is, you can actually play like that and win quite easily. So that was a really solid play from Powder. A bit unfortunate for Game King in a few of those matches. I think he got the rough end of the stick, especially in that Priest game. I mean, he did get the Sneeds into Rag, which is pretty insane. But Powder having the answers already locked in was, you know, huge. And then the value game just becomes too hard, especially when Draxus comes down.
Absolutely. But the Game King did play really well, and he's getting $500 for 16th place. So Powder, congratulations on advancing through. Like, first question will be, how did it feel when the Ragnaros dropped?
my heart kind of sank a little bit in my chest. It's always like you want to be above 14 life. Like, you have to play around Arcanine, Flash Heal. And then when the Ragnaros hit, I was like, okay, this is done. I need to top deck Reno. And then, I mean, obviously when he dropped the Arcanine afterwards, I was like, okay, maybe I can still win. Because I had obviously very good answers. So
yeah,
worked out in the end.
All right. So coming back to the first match, was versus Paladin, I believe. When the Brand got cleared, were you really happy with the Demon Wrath, just clearing the whole board?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you really need, like, if you don't have your early drops, which I really didn't. I didn't have Zombie Chow or Peddler. You just need one AoE spell to clear his board, and then you're in a pretty good position. So when I could clear his board completely on turn 4, I was pretty favored, I thought. And I had some good follow-up as well.
Overall, did you feel favored coming into that match with the Reno Lock, like against Priest, possibly Zoo, and Paladin, Secret Paladin?
Well, when I sat down and I saw his classes, I think I was very, very favored. Just because I had Rogue and Reno, which if he played Zoo, I mean, both those have three really good matchups. So I think he kind of thought I was going to play something else. I changed it up a lot since yesterday, so kind of worked out today. It's kind of 50-50. Like, you never know what he's going to bring. And it's a little bit of luck and some good choices, I guess.
Yeah, what was the reasoning behind the sort of demon variant of the Reno Lock versus, like, the, because I'm guessing you're not playing any Burst in that deck, like the Burst combo, because you're playing demons.
Yeah, I played the combo Reno yesterday. So it was kind of a little bit, like, I wanted to mix it up a little bit as well. And I've played the demon version a lot more in the past. Like, I've only switched up to the combo version, like, the last week. And I haven't really liked it that much. It loses some matchups where I don't really think Reno should lose, like against Priest and against Warrior, where you're thinking like, oh, I should have better minions, but then you're still sitting with your combo and they're at like 28 HP and you can't do anything.
Well, we saw some of that yesterday in one of the matches as well, where it was just like you had the combo pieces, but then you're just like, well, if I do them now, I'm still out of reach of that health, and then classes like Priest can just continually stay out of that
exactly.
range.
So do you think that the Demon Demon Reno Lock is a bit better than the combo one, or does it really depend on the matchups?
Yeah, it depends a lot on the matchups. I wanted it to be better against Paladin, which Demon Reno is a little bit better. It's I mean, it's not very big difference, but sometimes you draw, like, your demons, and, I mean, when you have Voidcaller and against, like, aggro decks, and you can get in Draxus or Mal'Ganis, like, it's just, like, another win condition where your combo pieces are completely useless. It's also a little bit better against Druid, but overall I just wanted to beat more of the control decks where, I mean, I can say what decks I had after. I had Patron and Rogue, so I kind of just wanted something to beat all the control classes, and I think Reno Warlock is pretty good at doing that.
Yeah, and the next opponent you're going to face tomorrow is Tice. So are you guys hyped for the match?
Well, I beat him last year here.
Oh, I can't remember.
No, I don't remember that happening.
I bought it up already, yeah. I said it already.
Yeah, he actually mentioned it in the very beginning.
You know, it's going to be a good match. I mean, if you want to get to the finals, you have to beat the best. So, I mean, why not beat Tice in the quarters?
And you guys can still change classes for tomorrow, so you can surprise each other or basically bring the same things. But I know Tice. Strong to them. So what do you have to say to Powder facing tomorrow?
No, I don't really have to say something. Yeah.
be able to cast maybe one more today, later, because we have six more matches. Six more matches?
Six
more matches. Yep. All right. So, yeah, that will be it for that match. Thanks so much for watching this one. We have six more for you prepared in the near future. But right now, give us some time to prepare the next match. And after that, more Hearthstone.